This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes how to use the net present value method to evaluate long-term investments. And that's the gist of the first bullet point here. So net present value, also called NPV, is calculated as the present value of all future cash inflows minus the present value of all future cash outflows. I have a separate lecture that describes in a very basic way how to calculate the present value of future cash flows. So you have to take a look at that to get a better sense of how to do that. I'll talk more about that as well with this lecture a little bit later. The last bullet point here, you'll note, shows that if the resulting NPV is positive, that is, once we take the present value of those future cash inflows minus the present value of those future cash outflows, and take one minus the other, if that resulting net present value is positive, then we accept the investment, we go ahead with the investment, something like, say, we're considering building a production facility. We go ahead and do that, accept that investment. And if the net present value is not positive, then we reject the investment. There are three important steps that we need to take to find the net present value, or NPV, of a particular proposed investment. First of all, step one, we have to identify the amount and timing of the cash flows required over the life of the investment. Got to know what they are. How much do we have to spend on that investment, and what are the cash flows in and out over the life of the investment? Secondly, step two, we need to establish an appropriate interest rate to be used to evaluate the investment. And then the last step is to calculate and evaluate the NPV to determine if we should take that investment on. Here's an example that we'll be looking at to learn how to use this NPV method. Let's assume that we are Jackson's Quality Copies. We're a company that makes copies for other people and other companies, and that we're considering the purchase of a new copy machine. We would be paying $50,000 today for that new copier, and we expect it to last 7 years. The annual maintenance costs on the new machine will be $1,000 a year, but we're going to have some labor cost savings of $11,000 a year. And then we expect to sell the copier at the end of 7 years for $5,000. So those are the cash flows. We have to lay out the cash flows, and you see that information here. Here's a formal presentation of step one in the example that I just showed on the previous slide. We identified the amount and the timing of the cash flows. Right, that we see that down below, the timing and the amount of the cash flows required over the life of the investment. So you'll see here, to summarize, that today we need to pay out $50,000 for that copy machine. And then it shows each year what will be happening with our cash flows. And so I'll just look at year one with you here. And in year one, we're showing that we're going to have maintenance costs of $1,000. That's cash out, so it's got brackets around it. It's a negative cash flow. And we're going to have labor savings of $11,000. That's positive cash flow, so that's cash flow in. And therefore, the total cash in for year one is $10,000. And you'll see that for each year through year seven. And then in year seven, there's one additional item we have to consider. And that is that we will sell the equipment, and we think that we'll be getting about $5,000 for it. So that's cash coming in. So here we've identified, this is step one, we've identified the amount and the timing of the cash flows required over the life of this proposed investment. The second step then is to establish an appropriate interest rate to use to evaluate this investment. And so the first bullet point that you see here, the interest rate is typically based on the organization's cost of capital. I mean, that's at least a starting point. And realize, I'm giving you a very quick summary here. There are finance classes that might take an entire semester to discuss how to come up with the cost of capital and the appropriate rate to be used for these types of investment proposals. So I just want to give you an idea of some of the things that companies consider when they establish the interest rate. So typically companies will start with the cost of capital. They might actually use that as their interest rate, and they might adjust it accordingly. But we'll just assume in the case of what we're doing here that we'll use the cost of capital as the interest rate. So in the second bullet point, how do we find the cost of capital? Well, it's typically the weighted average costs associated with debt and the equity of our company. So I like to put this on the board in class when I go through this. I'll do it briefly here. Here's our balance sheet equation, which is assets equals liabilities plus owner's equity. And realize that the funds that we get on the right side of this equation are used, at least in the long-term debt and the equity funds that we get from this equation, are used to purchase assets. And then hopefully those assets are put into use by our company and produce revenues, which ultimately, going over to the income statement, produces profit. So what we're looking at here is, what is the cost of the long-term debt and the equity? What is the cost of those funds? You know, that's what we call the cost of capital, and typically it's some kind of average of those two items. I'm going to just give you a quick example, and this is very loose. Again, you'd learn much in much more detail in the finance class how to do this, but let's say that our long-term debt is, I'll write up at the top of this, that our long-term debt is about cost us about 5%, and our owner's equity costs about 15%. I'm just using rough numbers here. And then let's say that we have about a 50-50 mix. So about 50% of our funds are raised through long-term debt, about 50% of our funds are raised through owner's equity. That would mean that the average of these two percentages is 10%. You could say 5% plus 15% is 20, divided by 2, that's 10%. You can also see here that right in the middle of those two, I set this up nice and neat, is an average of about 10%. So again, very loosely, but just to give you a sense of how this is done, our cost of capital here in this example would be about 10%. So I'm going to write that over here on the side, because we're going to use that on the next slide. So let's just assume that that's the rate that we're going to use to evaluate the project. So the third bullet point here, the general rule is, the higher the risk of the investment, the higher the interest rate used in the net present value analysis. And then there's some other terms that are also used to describe the interest rate. One is required rate of return. Another one that I don't have here, I'll just write it in, is hurdle rate. Got to get over that hurdle to be able to take on that investment. So that's another example of a term that is used to describe the interest rate. So that's step two, establishing the interest rate that we're going to use to evaluate the investment. Step three then is to calculate and evaluate the net present value investment. That is to determine, are we going to take it on or are we not going to take it on? And you'll notice that 10% that I talked about in the previous slide, you're going to see that right here, bottom left of this chart. You'll see that we determine that R will be 10%. And what we're doing here is we lay out the cash flows, which we've already done. You'll see that right here, right? This is our cash flow. Everything down to right there represents our cash flow. And then below that, down at the bottom here, we're going to determine the present value of those cash flows. And that's what we're doing here in step three. And to determine the present value of those cash flows, we're going to look up the present value factor, typically from the table that most textbooks provide. We're going to look up the present value factor. So for example, we're going to take, typically n is the number of periods. So in this example, in this column right here, n is 1, and r is 10%. And so the factor, when n is 1 and r is 10%, is 0.9091. And as I said, there are typically tables provided in the chapters that talk about capital budgeting to find these, what I call factors, present value factors. And what that 0.9091 represents is the present value of $1 received in 1 year given a rate of 10%. So if I want the present value of $10,000 received at the end of 1 year, and it is cash in, it's a positive number, then I'm going to take the 0.9091 and multiply it by $10,000. And therefore, the present value of that year, those year one cash flows, is $9,091. That's the present value. That's what it's worth today in today's dollars. And the same process is used for the remaining years. So this is the present value, this $8,264. Of my year two cash flows using the same calculation process, and present value for year three and year four, five, six, and seven. Then we take all of these cash flows, including, by the way, this initial cash flow. Don't forget that $50,000 cash out that went out today, but it is also the present value of that cash flow. We're going to take that negative 50,000, and then since all of these others are positive, add all of these others to that. You see these plus signs along the way here, right? We're going to add all of those, and it turns out that our present value of all of these cash flows is right here, and that's actually called then the net present value. So the net present value of this investment is $1,250. And it's important to note that that is a positive number, and that's going to be important as we go to the next step. The next step, which is also part of step three, the last part of step three, is to decide whether to make the investment. And it's pretty straightforward. First bullet point states that if the net present value is greater than or equal to zero, then we're going to go ahead and accept the investment. Otherwise, we're going to reject the investment. And so here in the previous slide, we've determined that this proposed investment to purchase this copy machine is a positive $1,250, and therefore we accept. A positive net present value, last bullet point here, indicates that the expected return on this investment is greater than our company's required rate of return, which was 10% in this example. And in this chart below, it just shows that we calculate the net present value here, and if it's greater than or equal to zero, yes, we accept the investment, and if it's not, it's a red light. We do not accept it. We reject the investment. Now we'll look at an alternative way to calculate the net present value of a proposed long-term investment. So it's just a different way of calculating the same number. And we're going to use annuities, and it kind of helps us out to do that. But it makes the process a little more efficient. So what is an annuity? We'll start with that, and then I'll show you how to run the same calculation using the annuities that will help us out. Annuities, in the first bullet point here, are cash flows that are identical and occur at regular intervals. So as an example, we'll look at the copy machine that we're considering buying and the cash flows that are associated with that. In fact, we'll look at one specific cash flow. Remember that we expect that copy machine to last for 7 years. So I'll just draw a quick timeline. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Those are supposed to be even gaps. So we have this copier that we're going to purchase that will last for 7 years, and we expect to see, one of the cash flows is we expect to see some maintenance costs of $1,000 every year. So I would normally put that out for every year all the way out to here. This is an annuity. It's the exact same dollar amount, negative $1,000, and it's in regular intervals every year. What we can do then, going to the second bullet point here, is use annuity tables to calculate the present value of an annuity cash flow. And certainly these annuity tables can save us time. So let me show you on the next slide how we can set this up and calculate the net present value using these annuity tables. Again, we're calculating the net present value just like we did a few slides back, but using a different format, using the annuity tables in addition to the present value table that we talked about before. We have four different cash flows outlined here. The purchase price, which is $50,000, and that's today. We've got the annual maintenance costs that's going to happen. It's an annuity. It happens every year for 7 years, and that's going to be $1,000 negative, $1,000 going out. We've got annual labor savings. That's also an annuity, but it's a positive $11,000 that's going to be coming in every year. And then we have the salvage value. It's not an annuity. It's $5,000 that we're going to receive at the very end, at the end of 7 years. So we go to the present value factor tables, and there are going to be two different tables. Again, most textbooks will include this in the textbook, so you can find it in whichever textbook you're using. You can go to the tables to find the factor and use R equals 10%. So the purchase price of $50,000, that's happening today. So the factor there is 1. If we're paying out $50,000 today, then the present value of that $50,000 is the same. It happens to be negative because it's cash going out. We have annual maintenance costs of $1,000. So now we'll go to the annuity present value table and look up R equals 10% and N equals 7, because this is happening for 7 years, and you'll notice that the factor is 4.8684. That represents the present value of $1 being either received or paid out each year for 7 years at a rate of 10%. So we're going to take that times the 1,000, the negative 1,000, and that will give us a negative 4,868. So that's the present value of those future cash flows. It's an annuity, present value of that annuity. And then same process with the next annuity. It's $11,000 that's coming in every year, each year, times 4.8684, and that equals a present value of $53,552. And then lastly, we take the salvage value of $5,000. We don't use the annuity table here because that's not happening every year. That's just at the end of 7 years. And we multiply that by the present value factor of 0.5132, and that gives us the present value of $2,566. And then take all of these numbers, net them out, and that gives us a net present value of $1,250, and that number should look familiar. That's the exact same number we calculated earlier in this lecture a few slides back. So the net present value of this investment proposal is $1,250. This is simply an alternative way to calculate that number.